Well, this past week on Sunday Morning Quickies, we kind of ran out of time. Well, actually, I ran out of time. I didn't have time to prep for the Q&A that I had intended to put at the end of that video. So here we go. We're going to do the Q&A right now, like I promised. We'll start off. Brenda writes, and she was referring to the video Pivot Screw Madness. You said the vertical shaft pivot screw was 3/8 by 24th and by 24, and the rock shaft was 3/8 by 28. I have a 66. What's the thread of the vertical shaft? It looks very different. I don't think it's possible to mix them up. Well, Brenda, you are absolutely 100% correct. You cannot mix those up on the 66, the larger machines. That would be 1/2 inch by 20 TPI, so 1/2 by 20. Yeah, you can't possibly mix that up with a rock shaft. I was using the example of a 99 because that's what the customer who had the problem, that was how that was resolved. And next up, Angry, which let's put it this way. If somebody is writing something and they're being less than nice or something where my viewers might think less of a person, I'm either just going to use their initials or I'm going to say Angry or whatever. Angry writes, and I assume this was in response to my 221 Featherweight Get the Lead Out video. Do customers actually let you ruin their featherweights by changing out the original light wiring harness with that abomination you concocted? I can understand doing something like that to a lesser machine, like that 99 you seem to love so much, but to do that to a featherweight, and featherweight was in all caps. Yeah, they do. And, I just recently did it to a 201-2, as a matter of fact. But let's... to break down a little bit more of the myth of the featherweight. There were actually only about... less than 10,000 more 99s made than there were featherweights made in the whole production run, including, you know, the what happened at Elizabethport and killed Bowie. Featherweights are not rare. They're only rare because a lot of quilters might happen to own, 10, 20. I know one person who owns like 50 of them. So yeah, that's what, they're small and they're cute. And they're lightweight. Okay, I get it. But they're not the be-all, end-all of all sewing machines. They total production, I ran the numbers, total productions of 221 and 222 machines. So, because we're going to include the free arm versions as well. There was 2,084,917 serial numbers allocated for 221s. Now, we're going to assume that they allocated a serial number, they made it. We have no way of knowing what the actual production numbers were. And there was 108,900 model 222 serial numbers, for a total of 2,193,817. Okay. Total of all 99 and 99K machines made, 2,202,000. So it's like less than 10,000 more than the total production of featherweights. Interestingly enough, 201s, Singer in both... the New Jersey factory and the Scotland factory, total of 2,523,318 model 201s. Now, if we take the derived version, the model 1200, there was 6,500 of those for a total of 2,529,818. So, okay, there's a difference there of a couple of hundred thousand. But explain to me, somebody please explain to me why I can buy a 201-2 any day of the week for between $40 and $50, and I can't touch a featherweight for under a couple of hundred. Tell me why. Please, please, please tell me why. I rest my case. Anyway, but yes, people do like that modification. I haven't been doing it that long. I just came up with it relatively recently. But I've done it on several featherweights already. I just did it on a 201-2 for a customer. That machine actually is shipping tomorrow. All right, moving right along. St. Max, and I love that. St. Max writes, and this is referencing the 201-2 rewire, part 2B, rewiring the motor. Thank you so much for this video. Super helpful in my quest for repairing a 201-2. I wanted to share something. I noticed on the armature, the ground flat on the shaft for the worm gear also has a corresponding ground flat on the other end of the shaft where the windings are. If you look at the winding end with the worm gear pointed away from you. Yes, that's very true. And you're not the first person to point that out. I've done several videos talking about the potted motor since then. I just keep on forgetting to mention that. Sorry. I should have been mentioning that all along, but I haven't. My bad. You got me on that. But you're not the first one to get me. I think Joe Mercer was the first one to get me on that. Moving right along, Akula writes. Now, haha, Akula, you wrote that, your email, and it came across in the Cyrillic alphabet, and I had to translate it. Google Translate works. And also helps you with the proper pronunciation. Singer, this is referencing the Singer 101 Part 3 Supplemental Test Stitching. Check Radom 432, best zigzag machine I've ever seen. Needle and shuttle both move to make a perfect stitch without any issues like on typical zigzag machines. Yes, I have seen sewing machines set up like that where both the shuttle and the needle are moving back and forth, and I will agree, they make a beautiful zigzag stitch. There were quite a few Japanese machines in the 1950s and 60s that used that technique. For some reason, we don't see a lot of that anymore. And I've mentioned it before, where I live, I am definitely in Singer country. I've mentioned this several times. We are 14.6 miles as the crow flies from the Elizabethport factory. So very little non-Singer gets seen around here, except for a little bit of Bernina. But I have never seen in person a Russian-made sewing machine, but I'd love to get my hands on one. Okay, Donna Ford writes, and this is referencing my Singer 99 versus 221 featherweight video. Hey Bob, great video. Mine sews through 8 layers of denim, which I could not believe. The light on my machine, which looks exactly like yours, flops around too much. That screw that holds it on looks okay, but I'm wondering if there isn't a better way to stabilize the light. Would you have any suggestions? Yeah. First of all, I hate the Singer lights that were on the 99s. There's a couple of different versions of the Singer light. Actually, there's a lot of different versions of it. But if I recall correctly on that video, I was showing one that had the spotlight, I think they call it, and it's got the glass lens, and it's got those god-awful wire clips, which that isn't the worst of it. The worst of it is the darn switch that's in that light assembly. I despise it. So, yeah, flops around, no big deal. I pitch those whenever those switches go bad or the wiring gets bad. I tend to pitch those lights and put an aftermarket modern light on it with a real switch. I'll put a link down below to the one I like. If I recall correctly, I get that one from Central Michigan Sewing Supplies, but the correct link will be down below. But yeah, as far as if you want to use the original one, I believe that's a 12-28 screw holding it in place. You might want to add a washer between the head of the screw and the light unit. That might help. Or you might even need more than one. Like a lock washer might even help just to tighten up the connection between the screw and the light. That might help you there, Donna. Okay, FG writes, or emailed me, I hate your beard. Yeah. Okay. But also, same email farther down. So how much does Harbor Freight pay you to be a shill for their cheap as tools? How can anyone have the nerve to suggest anything from them? I guess you get paid by the Aerocryl people too, because you always mention that expensive stuff. WD-40 has always been the best. You have no dignity. You're a hack and a cheap shill. I hope you die. Well, thank you for your opinion. I have mentioned many different tools from many different companies in the year and a half or so that I've been doing sewing machine videos here on YouTube. Everything that I show, I have bought with my own money. I do not have any sponsorship deals with anyone. Harbor Freight, Kano, McMaster Car, nobody. I get no money, nothing free from anybody. Nobody in the manufacturing world even knows I exist. Do I want sponsorship deals? I really don't care. You know, monetization on YouTube is an interesting proposition. You have to have 1,000 subscribers and 4,000 watch hours in a 12-month period before you can even monetize your stuff. And then when you do monetize it, you essentially get, there's a rate that YouTube determines. And it's not the same for every creator either. I believe my rate is about 0.1 cent per view. So I don't even make a dollar until a video has 1,000 views. So yeah, the minimum check that Google sends for YouTube is $100. You have to have earn at least $100 before they will cut you a check. I go months sometimes, a couple of months before I hit $100 on advertising revenue for YouTube. So yeah, I'm not doing this for the money. I would be doing this whether I got that every other month or so check from YouTube or not. And I'm sorry you think I'm a shill and I'm a schmuck or whatever, but no, nobody's paying me anything to do this. I do this for the love of the craft. I do this because, yeah, like you said here, I hope you die. I'm going to die someday. And I think it's a shame to have knowledge and skills that you can share and to die without sharing them. That's why I do this, so that other people that come along after me might be able to learn some of the stuff, even if, and I don't know a tremendous amount compared to some of the people out there. But yeah, that's why I do it. So thank you very much for writing, FG, and you have a nice day. Anyway, that's what I've got for you for the Q&A. It's kind of short, sweet, and to the point, but this is about how long it was going to be if we did it on the Sunday Morning Quickies. So, thanks for watching, and we'll see you on the next one.